Okay. Okay, we go live now. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. I'm Veselin Popovski, the Vice Dean of the Law School in the OP Jindal Global University in India. And I have the pleasure and the privilege to moderate the panel on the role of higher education in addressing current and future challenges. As we all know, COVID-19 has spared no moment and no space in the world and poses existential questions and formidable challenges, not only to universities, but to our sectors in life, to every single individual on our planet. And it came when we had already a bunch of serious threats and challenges: climate change, extreme weather events, heats, flooding disasters that continue to endanger human lives. The speed of change is really unprecedented. And if we just compare to how our grandparents lived two generations back, when they were at the age of 20 or 30, they very much knew well what is going to happen in their lifespan. No longer in the 21st century. We don't know what will happen 5 to 10 years from now. And one good example are the jobs that dramatically change over less than a generation. Even in 2030, some statistics show that 30% of the jobs that companies will employ in 2030 are even unknown today. And that's interesting to bring back our profession as teachers. How do we teach students without knowing what in 8-9 years from now they will experience as possible employability and so on? So in this watershed moment, the universities must think and develop future leaders to be ready to deal with both national and global issues, to face a world where multiple realities can coexist, where alternatives, worldviews, and convictions have to be encouraged and negotiated with, and where students are taught to look beyond themselves in their immediate surroundings to the reality of interdependence and peaceful coexistence. We have an excellent panel today of five distinguished speakers: Professor Dr. Siraj Kumar, the founding Vice Chancellor of OP Jindal Global University in India; Pankaj Mittal, the Secretary General of the Association of Indian Universities in India; Sabu, the founding Director of the Indian Center in the University of Southampton in the UK; Colin, the Executive Dean of the Faculty of Business and Law in the University of Wollongong, Australia; and also from Australia, Professor John Shields, in the University of Sydney Business School. I will ask them first to tell our audience, how did your university adapt to the immediate challenge of COVID-19 over the last 19 months? In other words, how did you react to the challenge of closure of campuses, students teaching online, and all other related aspects of medical capacity, if you want, on campus? What were the challenges and how your institutions faced those challenges? And I go as the order of speakers I have already presented. Raj Kumar, please, your time.
Thank you very much, Vaseline, and welcome to all our distinguished panelists. And thank you for the organizers to actually put together this event and also include higher education as a part of the discourse. Because, you know, very unfortunately, most of the time when people involved in business and trade investment, you know, neglect the entire issue surrounding universities and higher education. And I'm delighted to be part of this panel when we are discussing the future of economy and development in which higher education is also included. So, Vaselin, unlike probably many parts of the developed world where there was a far greater internal capacity built over a longer time to even have online education capacities, virtual learning mechanisms and models, when the global pandemic hit us in the month of March 2020, our university, like almost every other university in India, had almost zero capacity to, you know, engage in online teaching. But what was quite remarkable is that within literally less than a week, we could end up essentially develop a robust, you know, model which ended up offering virtual classes, online learning for all our students. And I think the biggest challenge that we were trying to overcome at that time was the challenge of uncertainty that you alluded to before. Nobody was sure at that time whether this thing that was hitting us was going to last for a few weeks, a few months. And in any case, at least those of us who are not, let's say, working in the field of STEM and medicine, I'm a lawyer, I'm a law professor. I simply could not imagine that something like this will last for so long. But then there were four things that shaped our vision at that time. First, we were wanting to engage with faculty and students to promote flexibility. Second, we were committing ourselves to all forms of innovation. So that's the second aspect. The third was we were committing ourselves to freedom among the faculty members and the schools to ensure that their individual courses, the pedagogical approaches that they adopt will be based upon the individual schools and faculty members' decision. And the fourth one was adaptability. So I called it the FIFA model: freedom, innovation, flexibility, and adaptability. With that, we launched the entire academic program. But the problem was not only at that level. We had to ensure that the entire examination system, assessment system was also geared up to ensure that online teaching is a serious enterprise and not something at the margins. The second thing which was important at that time for us is to launch the entrance examinations for admission of the new cohort of incoming students in the year 2020. Hitherto, as you can imagine, brick and mortar campuses like us entirely dependent upon physical outreach of students across the country, students physically coming into a location and taking the entrance examination. All of that was changed, and we ended up launching the artificial intelligence enabled remote proctored entrance examinations, which admitted all the students into our 2020 batch in August 2020. We're fortunate to have a 50% increased enrollment of students in our university, despite the fact that the pandemic continued. And of course, the last year has also been in the same level. So we really think that we have reinvented and reimagined what this challenge has put before us. And we never stopped at doing everything that we always did for the last 12 years, and including the last 3 days, we organized the World University Summit, which brought together over 150 thought leaders from 100 plus universities, including over 100 vice chancellors and rectors. So a lot of learning, a lot of resilience, a lot of transformation has happened in the last 15 months. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Raj. Indeed, some institutions have been already prepared, because thinking ahead is very important when we educate the next generation. Exactly, as you say, those who are best prepared will face many other challenges which we don't know today. Now, next is Dr. Pankaj, please. Same question. How did your institution react in the last 18 months on the challenge of COVID-19?
Okay. Thank you, Wesleyan. As you know, that I am from Association of Indian Universities, and Association of Indian Universities is not a teaching institution by itself. It is an association of about 850 universities of India. So when this pandemic struck and all the universities and colleges were closed, students were sitting at home, teachers were sitting at home, we felt that as an association, what will we do? Because the teaching is not happening. But as Dr. Rajkumar says, we were really surprised that within a month or so, all our teachers started teaching online. But then Dr. Rajkumar is from an elite institution, so he did not have any problem of devices or infrastructure or capacity building of teachers. But India is a diverse country, so there were many, many issues with regard to the capacity building of the teachers, because teachers, they were not used to online teaching. They didn't know how to teach online. And some, they however acted, but that effective online teaching was not there. So we at AIU took it upon ourselves to do the capacity building of the teachers. So we ran many, many online courses to teach teachers how to teach online. We did a lot of work towards collaborations and say internships, and even guiding the teachers that which platform is to be used for effective teaching, because all of a sudden so many platforms came up, like which can be used for teaching, and the teachers didn't know which one is the best for them, or maybe which, what are the advantages and disadvantage of the other. So whether it was collaboration or capacity building or even the advocacy with the government to create the required infrastructure in terms of technology, that was all done by AIU. And in addition to academics and research, AIU is also dealing with the holistic development of the students in terms of culture and sports. So we did many cultural events also online, because when the universities were closed for almost a month, the students could not meet together, and there were many, many issues with regard to mental health of the students. So that mental health was taken care of by counseling by the universities, and also through some type of cultural events or sports events which we could hold online. So we tried to take care of students in all possible manners, physical, mental, by say academics, research, sports, maybe culture, everything. So we try to do it, and then we do hold many, many conferences, vice chancellor's conferences we hold every year. Again, we could not hold the conferences and we switched to online mode. So now we are almost used to having online conferences, and now it seems rather easier, time effective and cost effective to have online conferences. So I think the world is changing, and the new normal everybody talks about, in the new normal, maybe in future also, all of our conferences will be in the blended mode. Till now they were only face to face. Right now they are only online, but future I think will be the blended mode of education.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pankaj. Very, very inspiring, encouraging words to hear that. Now let's move to Southampton in United Kingdom and see how the universities there reacted to the pandemic and what are the challenges more specifically in their environment. So Professor Dr. Sabu.
Thank you, Professor Wesleyan. What a delight to be joining this esteemed panel. I think, you know, well, some of these points are already echoed, but I think one of the things that I'd like to really highlight is that, well, Britain or the rest of Europe was, you know, never used to this pandemic for the last 100 years. So when it came, the first thing was actually uncertainty, and also probably perhaps, I think, as Professor Rajkumar said, there was some confidence that, well, that, you know, people thought that, look, this will go, we can actually deal with it. But I think when it started really, you know, sort of, you know, appearing in different versions and so on, and what was happening in Italy, then British universities first, I think even before the government, actually what they did was, particularly the Russell Group universities, just like Dr. Mittal was pointing out, you know, there was actually a kind of a collection of meetings. The team up was actually quite fast, proactive and rapid. And they were ready to listen, consult, and adapt to the pandemic challenges. So that was actually one of the first things that I'd like to highlight. At Southampton, what we did was that we rapidly adapted to the online transition, because I think, fortunately, we had that digital infrastructure in place. You know, this is actually an institution where the optical fiber technology was invented. So that kind of facility was there. But then, even then, I think the biggest challenge was actually to train staff, as well as to orient students to really adapt to this new world and new technology. But in terms of the governance, what the university did was that there was actually an emergency management committee that was established, and they engaged experts. And for instance, you know, wearing my hat as a demographer and a global health expert, so I was actually fortunate to be in that panel with lots of uncertainty and questions. But then we had frequent consultations. We had mathematical modeling of different scenarios, incorporating social distancing, masking, and you know, other different forms of social distancing measures and so on. And the committees were really you could really call it the gold, bronze, silver and bronze command. So there are three different layers. And so one of the things that was really managed quite well was the communication, because you have to really have a centralized communication to tackle these challenges at the university level, because social media has been really active by then, you know, spreading lots of messages and so on. So we have to really control that one. But also, fortunately, within 4 months, I think our researchers developed a rapid saliva testing facility. So that means each staff members, I mean, like for instance, myself, I had probably 3 times the test in a month. So that was really helpful to really, you know, reassure, you know, in terms of the positive test positivity, etc. But also, the other big challenge was to really support students, because we have to really provide clear program-specific guidelines, because we can't really put the one-size-fits-all model, because of the variety of disciplines. And that was also quite challenging, because, for instance, some programs required extensive laboratory, you know, experiments and so on. So how do you manage that? And how do you really bring people, making sure that, well, there is, you know, there's no spread. And if there is an infection, then, you know, you would call off for another 2 weeks. There were lots of disruptions and uncertainties. But also the other thing I would like to really refer to also Dr. Mittal, what she said, that regarding the new methods of student engagement. And what we did was that we also attempted some kind of, we experimented a few things like virtual field trips. That really provided, so some of our students went to India, not physically, but they had this opportunity to work with some of the NGOs, for instance, to understand the real world. So the internships worked very well. And also in terms of enabling them to, you know, learn something about cross-cultural challenges, I think that's very, very important, because I think we have to have that kind of atmosphere ready and so on. Finally, I think I'd like to highlight the reconfiguration of learning and teaching tools. You know, for instance, we had, I mean, like elsewhere, we had both the asynchronous and synchronous sessions. So asynchronous means these are really recorded lectures. Students can, you know, listen to those lectures at their own time. But then the synchronous ones, we made sure that, well, they were not lectures, but they were really conversations. Because otherwise, you know, within 5 minutes, you can actually disengage students. So that was really one of the things. And also staff and student well-being sessions were held frequently, because I think, you know, suddenly, all of a sudden, that students started feeling that, well, you know, they were isolated and it had tremendous pressure on them. So that was also really brought in, and which I think ultimately which led to some student satisfaction and also the prevention of campus epidemic. Because in April last year, I think when England had the peak, the first wave, our campus had literally very few in single digit COVID positive tests. So that was actually but then the scenarios changed. So we are still battling in that road of uncertainty. Thank you. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Sabu. Indeed, quite interesting to see your perspective from the United Kingdom. Now, we are moving into another direction, into Australia, with two other of our distinguished speakers. First will be Professor Colin Picker. Please, your time. Same question.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. It's really fantastic to take part in another one of these events around the world. It makes us still feel connected, despite, you know, the challenges. I'm actually going to take a slightly different tack than what everyone else has been talking about, though I agree with what everyone has been saying, and our experiences has been somewhat similar. So the question, as I read it, was sort of future-looking. How can the universities survive and adopt in a post-pandemic world? So after right now. So I'm really thinking about the future across the long term and a macro perspective. The first thing is to say, well, what are going to be the major differences that we're going to experience? Well, I think the single largest impacts on higher education is going to be constrained funding, and that's governmental, philanthropic, and student income, whether domestic and international, in part because of increasing competition, which I think we're going to see. I think we're going to see reduced mobilities, changed teaching styles, which we've already been experienced, but I think they're here to stay. So as remote and online plays a larger role. And then an increased demand that research has demonstrable impact, which is exists in some places already, but I think will be growing by governments and other funders as we go forward. So what are the consequences of this? How do I think universities can respond to these and the other forces? Well, one is I think universities need to be realistic and they need to accept this new reality and they shouldn't cling to outmoded approaches. That's hard for universities which are inherently conservative. So an acceptance, for example, that universities' reliance on foreign student income to subsidize operations and research is going to be substantially reduced. And for those of us in Australia, this is a very major problem. Also, and we should definitely ensure that the erroneous view that remote and online is a passing fad is definitely excised. So how else can we deal with this? Well, I also think we need to sort of double down to identify who we are. We need to identify what is the identity and purpose of our institutions, figure out who they are and what they should do. So in some cases, being comprehensive will simply not be possible. And that's both substantively as well as structurally within what we do, whether it's postgrad and undergrad or whether it's all disciplines. We also should accept that there's more than one model of success. In other words, we move away from the rankings. Rankings as the sign of success has sort of dominated higher education across the last decades. And I think we need to return to our roots, and that's substantively as well as to our core constituents. Now, part of the way that we can do this is, and this is the last thing I'll talk about for what is, I think, in the future, is we have to work with and persuade governments, local and national, as well as our regulators and our accreditors, to provide the supports and flexibilities needed for universities to have the space to adjust that we need. So, for example, rules restricting foreign providers and partnerships should be removed or relaxed. Different modes of teaching should be allowed to be trialed. Burdensome demands that are outdated need to be removed. For example, some of the onerous library requirements that we know are just out of date. So I think those are some of the things that universities, higher education, needs to think about as we deal in the post-pandemic world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Colin. Thank you for your perspective and important overview. And also from Australia, my pleasure to ask Professor John Shields also to join our discussion about the reaction of the university on the pandemic over the last 18 months. Your time, John.
Thank you so much, Veselin. The Australian higher education sector is in a rather peculiar position. And there's one stat that really sums it up, and that is that between one quarter and one fifth of your typical Australian universities annual revenue comes from international fee-paying students. That revenue stream is important and it's likely to continue to be important, and I hope it does remain important, but it's under direct threat. Our borders in Australia are shut tight at the moment, and those international students who are onshore are really struggling right at the moment in the eastern capitals because those capitals are in lockdown and getting paid employment to pay your fees and pay accommodation is really very difficult at the moment. So that's the situation revenue-wise and international education-wise. What has UCID done, my university, done to date around responding to the immediate challenges of the pandemic? I'll single out three things. The first thing that happened right at the start of the crisis in March last year was that our finance unit shut the door on non-critical spending. So there was a hiring freeze, there were major cuts in infrastructure and project funding, there was a freeze on academic access to their research funds, which caused a lot of grievance. We have had one round of voluntary redundancy, and that saw about 250 departures from professional and faculty staff. We've not to date had any forced redundancies. So there were immediate austerity measures put in place that appear to have saved us several hundred millions of dollars, which is no mean feat. The second thing that that we did was to engage in online targeting of our current and prospective students to retain, recruit and convert them. We launched peer-to-peer student communication platforms for prospective students using current students as, if you like, virtual ambassadors. That worked exceptionally well, and we were delighted with the outcomes. We used personalised outreach to prospective students via phone calls and via personalised media social media campaigns. And that targeting, as I'll share in a moment, appears to have helped us financially. The third thing that we did, in line with what the other speaker have said, is that we pivoted wholly to online learning. Sydney University has been traditionally a campus-based provider, but within 3 months we made the transition to wholly online lecture delivery and small group learning as well. And that went surprisingly well, and I think it partly is explicable in terms of the infrastructure investment that we've been made in the pre-pandemic era to get our LMS up to speed, to get the IT system working really well and the like. And that, I think, has been a saving grace for us. We use digital footprints to improve our connection with our offshore internationals, particularly those in China, which is our single largest cohort of international students. We use the WeChat platforms to onboard students from China and to outreach to them during semester. For the past year, our lectures have been wholly online. Our small group classes has been a mix of on campus and online or hybrid. One of the things that we did exceptionally well as a business school was to move our work integrated learning to digital mode, so virtual immersions. I'm really surprised, pleasantly surprised at how well that worked. We also have put in place a program called Job Smart Edge, which is an online, now it's online, it's an online engagement with international students to help them craft their broader capabilities. So it's a co-curricular activity. That has gone exceptionally well and reaches out to hundreds of different students. So what are the current challenges we've got? One problem that I think is looming large is that we've got an over-reliance on international students from one country, that is China. As it happens, the Chinese exposure has been a saving grace for us in that Chinese students, compared to students from more price-sensitive markets, have been willing to study online with us. But I don't think that is likely to last, and we certainly can't assume that it will. So 2022 is shaping up for us as a year in which I think we're going to have to reset the way that we engage with the international market, certainly not walk away from it, but to reset. And so we've got some big questions. What will recovery really look like for us? Will those students who've not been tempted by remote learning return to us once our borders reopen? How will we manage the likely recurrence of border closures? The Australian government seems to be enamoured of border closures. And how should we pursue diversification without alienating our current Chinese student constituency? That is crucially important to us. These are big questions, and we'll be engaging with them from now on. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John. Before I move to a second question, I see some very senior corporate people in our audience, so I would like to ask them probably to ask what would they be interested to hear from, because we pretty much know ourselves well. So if anybody from the audience would like to tell us what in particular do you want to hear from our panel, feel free to jump in at any moment, unmute your mic, write in the comments. Don't feel like there is a program to follow. We want to be as interactive as possible, so please bear that in mind. And my second question, and last one, because we don't have much time left, by the way, only 20 minutes, is how do you see the longer-term challenges of your institution, having in mind the lessons learned over the 18 months? Well, how do you see your institutions moving in 5 to 10 years from now? Please, Rajkumar first.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Vasilin. It's fascinating to discuss our distinguished panelists sharing their experiences, both from their institutions and from their own countries. Let me begin by saying that I am very optimistic about the future as far as our university is concerned. As you are very much aware, we are a non-STEM, non-medicine university that actually has worked to our advantage. we feel that there is a very strong interest in liberal arts, humanities, social sciences, and professional schools, and we intend to build deeper engagement on those disciplines. And I do believe that that those disciplines have a unique advantage of not significant investment in equipment and laboratories and those type of things, which actually poses huge financial constraints for many, as you heard from some of our colleagues here. Second, historically, and even today, we have very little reliance, if at all, on international students for our revenue budgeting. We don't, in fact, quite ironically, unlike the entire Western world, which depends upon international students for their budgeting, our international students, almost all of them, are on scholarships. We actually provide even 100% scholarship to students from different parts of the world. For us, internationalization, as far as inward mobility from international students, is not about making more money out of it, but actually providing access to the developing world, including in Africa and South Asia. So we have never relied upon international students for as a student revenue model. And again, it has worked to our advantage. And the third, I think, which is actually very important for us, is that we are, to a large extent, an undergraduate research institution, which means that over 80% of our students are undergraduate students and 20% of them are masters and PhD. We build our research culture and traditions to that. And I do believe that that is going to be going stronger in the future. I also think that the interest among Indian students to study abroad, particularly for undergrad education, is going to dwindle in the years to come for a number of reasons. And that will work to our advantage. And I do believe that there is an opportunity. From the internationalization standpoint, I want to tell our international friends and partners, including the ones here, we need to reimagine internationalization. The idea of physical mobility and spending millions of dollars to go and study and spend 3, 4, 5 years abroad and then possibly not getting a job and to reimagine the return on investment out of international education. All of this has to change. A radical tectonic shift has to happen in regard to internationalization. And we need to look at deeper and pervasive relationship in internationalization through Indian partners, including Jindal, but also others, where the internationalization has to be conceived very differently. Lastly, I will say that I think it is only fair to say that India, as a higher education hub, can also emerge. There is a growing trend with regard to Indian universities preparing themselves to do better. The National Education Policy has created an agenda for reimagining the future of Indian higher education. This is an opportunity for Indian higher education to focus on improving quality, promoting excellence, building research capacities, hiring good faculty, liberalizing the regulatory ecosystem, and ultimately recognizing that the demographic situation in India, which essentially means that over 850 million people are less than 35 years of age, when good part of the Western world, including China and Japan, will become older, India will be younger and will be younger for a longer time. This essentially provides a fantastic opportunity for Indian higher education system to blossom and to attract students from around the world. The cost is an important factor. We could offer fantastic education at a very significantly lower price. This is an opportunity for Indian higher education to go global in all forms and manifestations.
Thank you very much, Rajkumar. I see two questions from the audience, and I would like to bring them now because of the shortage of time. One is from Dr. Mitilesh Singh, the senior fellow and head of the RPJ State Education Research Center. How to cope with the challenges of engineering students who need lots and lots of practical experiences in learning on hardware on campus? And for that matter, for any other student in medicine and so on, is one. And Nitin Poddar, I would like you to ask your question directly.
First of all, thank you very much for accommodating me. And I really look forward for this fantastic panel. I don't want to waste time on the question. My quick question is, does it make sense to have a broad global curriculum so that it not only addresses the current challenge, but also future challenges? Because we need mobility of students and we need some kind of uniformity in terms of addressing the technological advancements globally. So does it make sense, like SGD, we have sustainable development goals. Does it make sense to have global common minimum standards for curriculum? whether it is medical, engineering, or whatever. Thank you.
That's clear, Tintin. Thank you very much. I would like all speakers, no particular order, whoever wants to answer those two questions, please unmute and talk.
Sabu, go for it. I have already said a lot.
So I think what a pertinent question. I think you've raised a very important question. For example, I think just to give you that internationalization of curriculum should be really the top priority, because I think when we talk about global challenges, like from climate change to health to other aspects, I think it's very, very important that sharing of knowledge is very important. And regardless of whether a student comes from medicine or from any other STEM area, they should be exposed to understanding about history, for instance. There's quite a lot of things that you can learn from history. So that, I think, unfortunately, we have been siloed in our own disciplines for a long time, and I think this is now the time to really break that vicious cycle and then explore the new opportunities. For example, just to give you one example, is that in my own university, we have now started a new module on India. It's called Emerging and Resilient India, and the reason, and this is really first of its kind in the British universities. Part of the reason is that in the next 35 years, so just Professor Rajkumar was mentioning about that size of the younger age population. So the next 35 years is going to be India. There is no doubt about that. Whichever university in the world, they will be really looking at India. So therefore, I think it's important. And not just that, but also the students, for instance, British students or any other students, international students, they will be working with their Indian counterparts. So an understanding of India is very, very much important. I think not by really... Of course, there are huge information on the internet systems, but I think beyond that, I think it has that you have to really embrace this into curriculum and also provide credits to that. Thank you.
May I? thanks for the question. I'll try to respond to the questions posed by Mithilesh and Vasilin. Mithilesh mentioned about what happens in the subjects where practical training is required, for example, engineering or medicine. So, of course, it is a difficulty because, I mean, practical subjects, you have to have hands-on experience. But the second best possibility is coming in forms of virtual lab. In India, we have many virtual labs called vlab.co.in, if you want to go to there. So virtual labs are there, and many, many simulations techniques are being used to teach students online for the practical skills. That is happening. And responding to the Vaseline question about what will be changing after the pandemic in the Indian higher education scenario, I think everything will be changing, because the questions will remain the same: what to teach, how to teach, and how to assess the students. But the answers will change pre-pandemic and post-pandemic. What to teach, I mean, curriculum, of course, we are talking of internationalizing the curriculum. How to teach, in India, we were using basically the lecture method. Now we are switching over to, say, flipped classroom method or blended mode of learning, where a lot of technology will be used. And how to assess and evaluate the students in India, we were basically using the 3-hour examination at the end of the semester, and we saw during the pandemic that how challenging it was to hold that 3-hour examination also. So the shift will be towards a continuous assessment of the student throughout the year or throughout the semester, and that too in a blended mode. So therefore, almost the answers to all the questions will change. The questions will remain the same, but the answers will change pre and post pandemic.
Thank you very much. Anybody else from Australia? Any views on those two questions? Colin or John?
Just a really quick, I'll take a different tack on the questions, which are damn good questions. I take a more philosophical approach to this. Look, the technical knowledge is, we do need to make sure we've got consistent standards in things where human life and limb are at risk, and particularly in engineering and medicine. They've got to be common standards across the world, absolutely. But there's got to be more than that as well. Our role as universities is not just to turn out vocationally, technically competent students. It's to turn out students who are open-minded, constructively critical, culturally competent, and globally minded. And that's where I think the more universities that can embrace the UN principles of responsible management education in our space, in business, or the principles of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, they, in my view, are mission critical to the future of the academy. There's so much untruth washing around the world in terms of internet discourse and social media discourse, that if anything, the role of universities, no matter what the technical basis of the university, no matter what where they come from in terms of disciplinary space, the critical issue here really is educating people to apply critical thinking to solve real-world problems in an evidence-based way. And if COVID has proved anything to us, it's that that is the only hope that humanity has to save itself.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John. Wonderful. We have about 6 minutes left. So, again, I encourage our audience at any time to ask more questions.
I think Colin wanted to respond as well, Vasilin.
Oh, sure. Colin, go ahead. Sorry.
No, absolutely. I mean, the only other thing I would say, other than the great responses that have been presented so far, is the role of these global accreditation bodies. I think perhaps that's part of the answer. Now, in the area of business, we actually have quite a few of them now. And I suppose there's some good questions as to what they might actually do. I know I've chatted with people about that at times. But certainly, they set a base. And that base is something which most of the universities that will join are probably already at, but it certainly sets the standard across the world for where aspiring participants should be at, even if they're not actually going to be applying for those. So it sets a sort of gold standard. And I know that most disciplines, we're seeing the emergence of these sort of global accreditation bodies of one form or another. Thanks.
Thank you, Colin. And indeed, we also often discuss diversity and meritocracy. I wonder what could be also the future challenge of bringing in particular in the context of diverse countries such as India, but also definitely Australia and most of the European countries. How do we reconcile diversity with meritocracy in the future? If somebody would like also to address that challenge, be most welcome.
Yeah, well, I'll quickly respond to that, Vasilin. I do believe that part of this challenge needs to be addressed at the secondary education level as well. We need to build capacities, better capacities at the secondary education level so that all the burden and responsibility should not be only with universities and higher education institutions. At the end of the day, the fact is that all over the world, and definitely in India, there is a supply problem when it comes to high quality institutions, and there are far fewer places available for a far larger number of students competing for it. While every effort should be to make to promote diversity and inclusion, universities are better suited to provide access through scholarships and fellowships, as opposed to using differential merit structures when it comes to determining who gets in and who gets out. In fact, almost always such differentiation ends up being challenged in courts of law. US has been battling those issues for many, many years, and as recently as last year. So I do believe that universities should be more conscious of its own approaches towards promoting diversity and inclusion. I think in the Indian context, the one of the better ways by which we need to do that is we need to use a broader and a more holistic approach towards selection process. Most of Indian higher education historically has depended upon the single examination that one takes at the end of the high school, and that will determine destiny and the future of anybody's life. That has fortunately changed in many of our institutions. We need to build on that. That is the spirit of the national education policy as well. And that's how we may want to promote diversity and inclusion within our higher education systems.
Thank you very much, Racha. I would like to use the remaining minute for a final round, so the rest of the speakers can obviously address my question, but at the same time also anything else you would like also to tell as a final message to the audience of the Horasis India meeting, be most welcome. Who wants to go next? Dr. Pankaj, Mittal.
Okay. Sure. See, I feel that pandemic, of course, this pandemic is one in a century crisis. Once in a century crisis, this pandemic had never struck. In our lifetime, it had never struck. But we should use this as an opportunity as well. because although it was a crisis, but it has taught us many, many things, because in crisis also we learn so many things. So it has taught us many things, how to be cost effective, how to be time effective, how to use technology, how to build new models, how to do blended learning. So I think if we learn many, many lessons from this crisis, we can still go on and with a greater force and a greater speed.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Pankaj, Mittal. Really, and our appreciation for your excellent work as part of the Association of the Indian University. We are very privileged to work with somebody like you. Thank you for your participation today. Next, Sabu, your final message to the audience for us. Right.
Thank you. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity to be with this, colleagues with fascinating ideas. So I think I'd like to really highlight one important thing, particularly as we think forward, is that what we need to really cultivate is the skill for imagination. I think that's what is lacking in our current students. You know, students when they come out of when they graduate, employers are saying that, well, probably about 85%, 90% of them are not employable because they lack, they lack even discipline-specific skills as well as interpersonal skills. So learning about, so that brings back to this same question of understanding, global challenges is very pertinent. And so that imagination is very important. That imagination will lead to that, research environment. I think that's also very much important, very, very important, because we need to really reflect on, and how do you make the learning exciting? I think this is going to be one of our major challenges. The one way to make learning exciting is to encourage students to undertake research. So you integrate actual projects that companies, that different industries are trying to struggle with. You integrate that into the education system. That's right. Integration of employment of employment requirements to education. Thank you.
Wonderful. I think this is very important for the audience today, because what we would like to see is very much closer cooperation between the industries and the corporate sector with the universities in terms of strategizing how shall we prepare the next employees for those corporations. I was told by the organizer that we can have extra minutes, so no time pressure. Colin and John, take as much time as you need for your final work today. Don't feel any limitation.
Well, thank you. I won't take long, because I know others might want to go into other sessions. Just to say, I think that these sort of discussions are critical, and the role of institutions to help those happen. So, for example, the role that JGU is taking as a node that then connects around the world and has connected me through to lots of other institutions around the world is one that's just been absolutely fantastic for us to learn how we're all doing things. So the comparative process that we engage, thanks to Raj and his colleagues, I really appreciate that. So I think that's the way of the future, more of that. So once again, thanks, Raj, and thanks the rest for inviting me on this.
Thank you, Colin. We must say that we also learn a lot from our partners in Australia. We are very inspired by all your excellent work you are doing over there. Thank you, Colin. John, please.
The learning is mutual. Let me just, I know I'm going to be normative, but 2 points. One is, it would be really tragic if universities around the world retreated to a form of educational nationalism. If there is an institution that can stand apart from and question the retreat to nationalism and populism that so many countries have been experiencing, it's the academy. I think we've almost got a sacred obligation as academics, as educators, as researchers, to stand up to that retreat to nationalism, and to demonstrate through our own internationalist activities and collaborations that this can work for the betterment of not only our own institutions, but for the betterment of humankind. Second thing I say is that the overarching objective of university education from this decade forward has to be future-focused learning, not that the great Irish poet W.B.H. once remarked that education shouldn't be about filling a pail or a bucket. It's about lighting a fire. It's about igniting a passion for learning and doing good. And by future-focused learning, I mean exactly that. And I mean also, as Sabu's been suggesting so wonderfully well, educating students, or rather developing students to acquire those deeper attributes or competencies that we know are going to endure long beyond the knowledge that they've picked up for now has been made redundant. So being able to influence, being cross-culturally competent, being a critical thinker, being innovative, being inclusive in the way that you relate to other human beings, and also being socially and environmentally responsible. These are the things that that millennials and Generation Z students are actually asking us to give them. And we've got an obligation to help them get there, I think. That's what I mean by future-focused education. And on top of that, it's lifelong learning as well. It isn't just front-end learning.
Lovely. Thank you so much, John. I've got a message from Frank Jürgen Richter, our organizer, that it was a wonderful panel already. So I don't really have much to add to that. And really, thank you, Raj. Thank you.
Veselin, can I just add one thing, Veselin, as we close?
Yes, please.
I just want to remind all of us that the extraordinary role that universities have played historically, I'm reminded of Alan Turing, the British mathematician who is considered as the father of modern computer science. As early at the age of 22, he became a fellow at Cambridge. He died literally at the age of 42. The foundational knowledge and understanding and perspectives that he generated led to the revolution in computer science. I say this because of the fact that there is something extraordinary about the role that universities can and have played and can and should be playing. We need to be mindful of that and not to be bogged down and even affected and impacted by the current crisis. The foundations of research that can lead to better preparedness, including the vaccine that many of us have put, the AstraZeneca vaccine, were created by researchers and professors at the University of Oxford. Similarly, many other researchers that are creating new science and technology inventions that are happening, the foundations are actually taking place in universities. Even our efforts to address problems in humanities and social sciences and law and business, universities have a very big role to play, and we need to constantly advocate that role and to ensure that we assert that space that we have, not for our own benefit, but for the benefit and future of humanity.
Thank you, Raj. There is no better way to end this discussion with your excellent final reminder of Alan Turing and how universities can drive the future prosperity of the humanity and the planet. Okay, I want to thank all of you, all our audience. I want to thank Horasis India Meeting for inviting all of us to be part of this amazing event today. I will stop streaming, but you can keep in the lobby if you want to share some of yours. Thank you all. Thank you. See you once again.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.